Hey, future PAs, aspiring healthcare professionals, and those just on the fence about what you want to do in your life. Welcome back to PA Coach Autumn. I'm Autumn and the host of this channel. This is the go-to place for all things physician assistant school. Today, we're going to dive into the journey of actually becoming a physician assistant from the undergrad days to donning that white coat. If you're curious about the timeline, stick around as we break it down step by step. I am going to go through multiple legs in this long journey. I'm going to start by talking about the undergrad degree and the prerequisite courses that are required to actually get into PA school. Then I'm going to jump into the shadowing hours, the time you need for shadowing hours, and who you should be shadowing if you're looking at becoming a physician assistant. Then we're going to review the clinical hours required for most programs and how to get them. These are the face-to-face, hands-on actual healthcare experience. Then we'll talk about PA school, what that master's program looks like, and how you get in. Finally, we're going to talk about hitting that finish line and graduating. After this, you got to study and you got to pass the pants. And then that's it. This video is going to be an overview of the timeline from graduating high school to getting that PAC. In future videos, I plan to dive into each section individually. But in the meantime, don't forget to hit that subscribe button for more insightful content. Let's get started. Okay, first stop, your undergraduate degree. Most aspiring PAs complete a bachelor's degree that is typically in a science or STEM-related field. This phase varies, but let's say it takes about 4 years. During this time, you're going to focus on prerequisite courses like biology, chemistry, anatomy. And the reason that most pre-PA and pre-med students choose a science-related undergraduate degree is due to those prerequisite courses that are required by most PA programs. Let's say that typically most of those PA programs require anatomy 1 and 2, biochemistry, physiology, biology, microbiology, chemistry, organic chemistry, English and writing, general psychology, genetics, medical terminology, and statistics. That was a mouthful. Obviously, each of these PA programs may vary slightly, but a strong science background is at the core of each of these programs. And getting an undergraduate degree in a science-related field ensures that the future PA students will have had a lot of exposure to these prerequisites, and they'll also have a solid foundation going into PA school. During this time, it is also extremely important to buckle down, study, and focus on that GPA. Most PA programs will take the average GPA of the classes above, so your science classes, which means you can't just fluff a GPA with R or freshman courses. Most schools are going to require that applicants have a minimum GPA of 3.0, but that doesn't guarantee entrance just because that's the minimum. The actual national average of GPA for students accepted into PA school was about 3.6. So if you want to be competitive applying this next round, the higher your GPA, the better your chances are. In future videos, I'm going to discuss what to do if you have a GPA that's on the lower side. But for right now, let's just say you're starting off on a fresh slate. This journey needs to start by you focusing on getting yourself on the right foot. That undergrad degree is the first part of the journey, and it's going to set yourself up for success if you study, work hard, and get those good grades. Okay, next up is shadowing hours, and this is where you're going to actually gain an understanding of what the profession actually is. Shadowing is a crucial component. You need to spend time observing PAs in action to actually understand what their role entails. You really shouldn't be applying to medical school, PA school, nursing school, or any healthcare related field until you have an understanding of what the day-to-day looks like for that chosen profession. During this time, you should be aiming for at least 50 to 100 hours to get that well-rounded perspective of what they do. Shoot for different healthcare settings with different providers. Don't just follow one doctor in one healthcare setting. For me, this was a crucial step when I was an undergraduate. I was completely convinced I was going to go to med school up until my sophomore year of college, when I became a CNA and I actually started working in healthcare and working day to day with doctors, nurses, PAs, PTs. I ultimately decided that the PA route was what was best for me. And in other videos, I'll go into detail of why I don't regret going to PA school instead of med school and why ultimately I'm very happy with my decision. Now, as for timeline purposes, let's say this portion can be and should be completed during your undergraduate degree. So it shouldn't add any extra years to the total time it takes to become a PA, which is great. If you can do it in undergrad, you should do that. Okay, let's talk clinical hours and clinical experience, which is different than shadowing hours in that it's paid, hands-on, face-to-face clinical experience. PAs typically need around 1,000 to 2,000 hours of direct patient care. If you have a lower GPA, this portion can really boost your chances of getting into a PA program. Clinical hours are direct, hands-on, paid for clinical experience. And examples of these roles are medical assistant, EMT, paramedic, lab assistant, phlebotomist, registered nurse, surgical tech, or respiratory therapist. Anything that is hands-on healthcare experience. Depending on the route you choose, this may add a few years to applying to PA school. The two routes that I saw most commonly in my own PA class were either students were part-time EMTs, CNAs, phlebotomists, or lab techs during school, or they worked in the healthcare field for a few years after graduation of undergrad degree before ultimately deciding to go back to PA school. Both routes have pros and cons. I would say that those who work in healthcare for a number of years prior to choosing to go back to PA school seemed, at least in my class, much more confident in their decision. They have usually worked side by side with doctors, nurses, PTs, OTs, and PAs for a number of years and have a better understanding of kind of healthcare as a whole and what they're getting into versus the new grad undergraduate like myself, who kind of knew what I was getting into but didn't have as many hours. Regardless, we'll say that the average time for this stage in the process can vary. It can add, you know, no additional time if you're working part-time throughout college, or it could add up to 3 years if you graduate and then work, you know, in that field for a few years. Regardless, this is a mandatory and vital step in honing your skills. And so every PA program is going to require some hands-on clinical experience. And to be honest with you, it's important you get this because you should have a, you know, really good understanding of what the healthcare field is like before you apply to PA school. Okay, so you have your undergraduate degree, you completed your prereq science courses, and you have your clinical and shadow hours. Now what? During this time of shadowing, attaining those clinical healthcare experience hours and getting those prerequisite courses done, you should simultaneously be prepping for your GRE, retaking any really low science grade classes, preparing your personal statements, asking for letters of recommendations, and applying to the CASPA. The CASPA stands for Centralized Application Service for Physician Assistants and opens yearly on the last Thursday of April and closes the following year on April 1st. Make sure, double check, to always check the specific program you are applying to for deadlines for submitting that CASPA. These are hard deadlines and you don't want to miss them. Once you've submitted the CASPA and your application is verified, which can take a few weeks, it will be sent to the programs that you've chosen and paid for. From then, the interviewing starts with, you know, each chosen program. This cycle will usually take the entire year, and if you're accepted, most PA programs will start in early summer and in the fall of that next year. In later videos, I'm going to go into a deep dive on the actual CASPA process and, you know, walking through it, but this is just a summary. Know that if you want to apply for PA school while in your undergraduate degree, you need to start your application in the spring of junior year and plan on applying and interviewing throughout your senior year. This is what I did, so I didn't have a gap year. If you want a gap year, start the application process in your senior year, and then you can plan on interviewing throughout your gap year and then starting that following year. Okay, you got into PA school, congratulations, you're in. This is the heart and meat of your journey. If you have made it this far, then congratulations and buckle up. PA programs usually take about 2 to 3 years to complete, and during this time, you have to expect an intense mix of classroom learning and clinical rotations. You're going to be covering, you know, a lot of various medical specialties. During this time, you need to expect to dedicate most of your time to the program. I do not recommend having a part-time job during this time, and most programs actually will not let you have a part-time job during this time. You are condensing a few years of medical school kind of training into 2 short years, and it's intense. You do not have a summer break, and most programs will go year-round. It's challenging, but it's incredibly rewarding as you're building the skills needed for your future PA career. Again, in future videos, I will do some deep dives on what to expect during PA school, but for right now, just know that this kind of phase of the journey is going to take about 2 to 3 years. Okay. You made it through the 2 to 3 years of rigorous PA school. Do you have some newfound anxiety of, oh man, I'm not ready to practice medicine? Absolutely. Have you made some lifelong friends? Also absolutely. Now it's time to study for the pants. As graduation looms, the last hurdle on that checklist is the Physician Assistant National Certifying Exam, the dreaded pants. Studying for this exam can take a few months for some, It's a comprehensive test assessing your medical knowledge and making sure that you are ready to practice clinical medicine. Passing the pants grants you the title of certified physician assistant, which is needed in most states to actually practice medicine. It marks the end of your formal education and the beginning of your professional career. Most programs will have ongoing pants prep throughout your clinical rotation year with practice tests, you know, monthly exams. My program at ISU, you know, had quarterly exams as well as monthly exams, and then sent us to a 3-day crash course in pants prep, which was super helpful. If you've been studying all of clinical year, you can usually take that pants as soon as you have that graduation and diploma in hand. Most of my classmates, myself included, took the pants within the first 2 months of graduating PA school. For some who felt they needed more time to study, they took it within the first 3 to 6 months. Personally, I recommend taking that test within the first 3 months of graduation, as you should still have your good study habits that allowed you to succeed in PA school. You're also going to have more things fresh in your mind, and you haven't had a break, so everything's kind of right there at the forefront. Obviously, everyone is going to be different, so whatever works best for you is the best way to go. But again, my personal recommendation is take that pants while it's prep, and then enjoy the few months you have before you jump into clinical practice. Okay, it's time to wrap all of this together. This is the condensed timeline of becoming a physician assistant, from undergrad to donning your white coat. It's a journey that combines education, hands-on experience, and a lot of dedication and a lot of hard work. For those of you who are kind of wondering, what is the shortest timeline from high school graduation to PA school graduation? Realistically, it can be accomplished in 6 to 7 years, but this would mean planning ahead, mapping out your clinical hours, mapping out your shadowing hours, starting your application to PA school during your junior year of undergraduate degree, and then graduating undergrad and going right into PA school. This is what I did, and while it did feel like a whirlwind, it was worth it for me. You know, there was added stress, but it really condensed that time for me. If you want to do things a little bit differently and take some time after undergrad degree to work in healthcare, you know, plan your applications or take breaks because life happens and, you know, some of us want to enjoy life before just diving back into school, then the process can take longer, but, you know, you may have a better quality of life for those years in between. The short is everyone is going to have a unique route to PA school, which means that there is always going to be diversity in programs with people from all walks of life, which is what makes, you know, healthcare unique. Okay, I just want to say that I love my job and I love being a PA. I don't regret my decision to become a PA, and I hope this video has been informative. If you found this breakdown helpful, give it a thumbs up and let me know your thoughts in the comments. Don't forget to subscribe for more insights into the world of healthcare and specifically becoming and being a physician assistant. Thanks for joining me today, and I'll see you in the next video. This is PA Coach Autumn, and thank you.